मॉर्निंग, गुड आफ्टरनून, गुड इवनिंग टू एवरी वन. टूडे आई वेलकम यू फॉर द अम्बेडकर लेक्चर सीरीज एंड टूडेज टॉपिक इज वन ऑफ द मोस्ट डिस्कस टॉपिक इन रिसेंट टाइम. द टॉपिक इज डॉक्टर अम्बेडकर फेमिनिस्ट फिलोसॉफी एंड वी हैव नन अदर दैन वन ऑफ द प्रोमिनेंट आई वुड से यंग feminist, Ambedkar feminist, who has recently written and has been working on Ambedkar's feminism. So without taking much time, I would introduce you to today's speaker, my friend Sunanya Arya. And before I invite her to speak, I would like to give her a short and very bright introduction. So Sunanya is editor of Dalit Feminist Theory, a reader, one of the very good book which she has edited with Professor Rathod, and she is senior fellow at the Center of Philosophy at Jawaharlal Nehru University, Delhi. She has earned her MPhil in the same center, and she has worked on Dr. Ambedkar's philosophy during her Master of MPhil. She has received honorable mention in the Bluestone Rising Scholar Prize 2019 by the Heller School of Social Policy and Management, Brandeis University, USA. She is founding member of Global Dalit Changemakers, an initiative of the India-China Institute, the New School, New York City. Sunanya has also been a resource person for various lectures, public talks, workshops, podcasts, and webinars in India and abroad. She has recently published, her recent publication includes Dalit or Brahminical Patriarchy. Everyone, I recommend to read that one. Rethinking India's Feminism, Theorizing Gender in South Asia, Dalit Feminist Perspective, and Ambedkar as a Feminist Philosopher. She has also edited with Professor Ashok Gurung, The Gender Special Issue of Caste, a global journal on social exclusion published by Brandeis University. So with her, with this much resource is enough for her to achieve this one of the youngest feminists in coming time. So before taking much time and delaying, I invite Sunanya to go ahead and please start the discussion or talk on Ambedkar's philosophy, feminist philosophy. Sunanya, please. You are mute, Sunanya.
I mean, you are muted, I guess.
Yeah, you are unmuted now.
Jai Bhim, everyone. Thank you, Dada, for your kind words about me and encouraging words. And thank you, Boston Study Group, for having me here. It's a pleasure to be in touch with the Boston Study Group, and I feel proud to be a part of your Ambedkar lecture series. And if people do not know about Boston Study Group in Delhi or around, so I would really recommend everybody to get to know their works and accomplishments, because what they are doing is marvelous. And generally, we don't understand what this Boston Study Group, Boston Study Group is an Ambedkarite group. So we need to know about their works. So thank you. And I would talk about this topic, Dr. Ambedkar's feminist philosophy. So how I see Dr. Ambedkar's feminist philosophy is, his contribution in the gender justice, not only theoretically, but also, practically. So I see it in two phases, two parts. That one is his theoretical contribution, because whatever he did in terms of Hindu code bill, that is a pragmatic, pragmatic resolution of what he had been going through intellectually before actually forming the Hindu code bill and the rights for women in India. So there are so many works on his Hindu Code Bill, and that is why I tried to not focus on that, but focus on his theoretical contribution to the feminist discourse, and that I call Ambedkar's feminist philosophy. So I would talk about how he criticized the patriarchal practices and patriarchal norms and the principles based on which people used to justify women being treated as a slave. So he has firstly criticized the ancient literature, mostly religious texts, which used to justify the inferior position of women in our society. And then I would talk a little about, like, I would also talk about how his feminist philosophy is contemporarily so relevant even today, which was at that time, and also that how mainstream Savarna feminists fail to recognize the significance of Ambedkar's contribution into the feminist discourse. So this would be like two parts of my presentation today. So firstly, I see that while reading Ambedkar's feminist texts, I found that he was really strongly critical of the religious texts which support dehumanization of women. So he had been seeing all the texts like a text, not like, having a blind faith into it is religion and we cannot question. So he was a great scholar and philosopher. So he did not discriminate between one text or the other text. He just wanted to see everything with a critical lens, so that he could justify whether one is helpful for us to have a progressive and just and equal society, or if there is something which we need to eliminate or criticize or see through a critical lens, so that we can understand, we can encounter that in our everyday living. So first, I present to you Dr. Ambedkar's critique of Ram from Ramayana. So why Ram? Because Ram is regarded in our society even today as an ideal man. And Ramayana is regarded to be a text which is like, rules and regulations and the blueprint for our human living, like that propounds as the ideal living. So that is why I picked this Dr. Ambedkar's critique of Rama. And how do we see that an ideal man can be, really patriarchal? So we have to question whether that person could be our ideal or not. So first, Ambedkar's words I will read. This is from volume 4, Baba Sahib Ambedkar Writing and Speeches, page number 327 and 28. So he writes about Ram, that how we all know about the Ramayan. So he writes about how Rama was treating Sita, being an ideal man and her husband. So this is in the context of how a husband and a wife relation should be of egalitarian, manner and not of, hierarchy. So Ambedkar says, it would be difficult to believe any man with ordinary human kindness could address to his wife in such dire distress as Ram, the ideal man, did to Sita. So there are so many versions of Ramayana, we know. So Ambedkar had referred to Valmiki's Ramayana, and he has quoted it every time he has talked about it. So from the Valmiki's Ramayana, he quotes Rama's words to Sita when she, after the, war between the Ram and Ravan. So he says that, I have got you as a prize in a war after conquering my enemy, your captor. So he calls his wife as a prize for his masculine powers of defeating Ravan in a war. So I have recovered my honor and punished my enemy. People have witnessed my military prowess, and I am glad that my labors have been rewarded. And then he says, I came here. So in Lanka, he goes there. So I came here to kill Ravan and wash off this dishonor. I did not take this trouble for your sake. So people would, in the common, bhakti songs about Ram, people would praise Ram that he did all that war, and he went through all that suffering and fought that mighty Ravan because he loved Sita so much. But here Ram himself says that I did not take this trouble for your sake. So now Ambedkar says, could there be anything more cruel than this conduct of Ram towards Sita? He does not stop here. So Ram does not stop by saying that I did not take this trouble for you. He says that I suspect your conduct. You must have been spoiled by Ravan. So your very sight is revolting to me. So instead of offering support or warmth some kind of soothing to the partner, he is continuing to blame her for her being kidnapped by Ravan. And then he says, oh daughter of Janak, I allow you to go anywhere you like. I have nothing to do with you. I conquered you back, and I am content, for that was my object. So like we see that how the objectification of Sita is constant in his dialogue with the Sita, that first he calls her a prize, then he says, I conquered you. So as if Sita being a mountain or a hill or some kind of material asset, that he is conquering her instead of protecting her, or like that is also a patriarchal word, but still, like, not instead of saving her or helping her get over misery, he is saying that I conquered you, as if first Ravan will conquer you and then I am conquering you. So there is no difference between he being a partner or a person who's kidnapping her. So I conquered you back, and I am content, for that was my object. I cannot think that Ravan would have failed to enjoy a woman as beautiful as you are. So that is from Valmiki's Ramayana, from this Yudhakand Sarg 115 shloka to shloka 1 to 23. So he says all of this to his wife, and says that you are allowed to go anywhere as you like. I am not going to get you back in my life because you must have been spoiled by Ravan. Now we see that even if a woman had been, sexually abused by a person who has kidnapped her, are we going to blame the woman that, you are so beautiful that he has conquered you, or he has, enjoyed you, the word he has used, and then tell her to go anywhere as she likes? And we know that in our society, the woman is once given in a marriage is not accepted the same way in her family, in her own native family. So he's saying that you go anywhere as you like. So he's not accepting her as his partner again. And to give him no excuse, Sita enters the fire, which we all know, the Agni Pariksha, and comes out unscathed. It is then Rama agrees to take her back to Ayodhya. And even then, he does not, stop there. Once people start gossiping about Sita's conceiving, like when she conceives, then people start gossiping in the Ayodhya that, she might have conceived the child from Ravan and not from Ram. At that time also, Ram did not, being a king, he did not use the authority to clarify the misunderstanding of the people, or stand stand up against those gossips and say that I have asked Sita to go through Agni Pariksha and now she's my wife and nothing of that sort. He had not played any kind of role as a partner to care for his wife. So that is the kind of person who is regarded as ideal man in our society. So Ram Ambedkar rejects Ramayana as a guiding principle of an ideal life, and he criticizes, Ram because he is an ideal man who's very patriarchal. And Ramayana preaches the slavery of women in marriage. So, like, once you get married, you have no right on your own life. And that is the kind of, belief is still existing in our society. So that is why against the principles of injustice, Ambedkar, questions the authority of Ramayana. And that is how I see that he's on his way to, criticize and reject all those kinds of texts or beliefs or principles which were preaching slavery of women or which were encouraging this hierarchy of men and women or inferior position of women. So that is one about Rama's critique from Ramayana. And then Ambedkar talks about Krishna. Krishna, see, now what about Krishna? There's so many books about Krishna, right? We all know, like, Krishna is like seen as a popular person for bhakti, So Krishna, who is an incarnation of the Supreme Being. So I want to highlight that how, these people have been, what positions have been given to these people, how they are revered in our socio-cultural context, and what they actually do with respect to women. That is being highlighted by Ambedkar. So Krishna keeps 8 chief wives, 180,000 children, and 16,100 wives whom he married on the same day. Of course, we know there are different narratives, different versions of it. But, like Ambedkar was reading the text as it were in the original. So, and Ambedkar learned Sanskrit to read all of that. So the chief wives have been rewarded to Krishna for victory in fights. So he had got Kalindi as a reward for fighting in a, little battle. And then there are they are offered to him as penalty or compensation for the defeat and fear. So Jambavati and Satyabhama had been given to him as a penalty and compensation because he had fought he had won over the fathers of these women. So the fathers had given away their daughters like a reward or penalty or compensation, as if it's some showpiece or, some kind of objective asset. So, and even for killing bulls. So he gets Satya for killing bulls. And he not only carries them off, so he carries Lakshmana off, including his cousin's Shishupala, fiance. So he carries off Shishupal's fiance Rukmini and even his own cousin Mitra Binda from their Swayamvars, but also advises Arjun to carry Subhadra off, who's Krishna's half sister, Balram's sister. So he tells Arjun to carry off Subhadra without depending on the chances of Swayamvar. And he's saying, be brave and carry her off. Don't depend on the chances of Swayamvar. Now we see the contradiction in this sentence, that he is saying, be brave, Kshatriya, and don't depend on the Swayamvar's chances. Just be brave and carry her off. So it seems that the bravery lies in stealing a person, stealing or doing something ill, unethical, instead of fighting with other men, what was the tradition at the time. So I remember, instead of doing that, there the idea of bravery for Krishna lied in, you know, carrying off a woman from a swayamvar instead of fighting in the swayamvar, as in like getting into the competition or winning over the competition. So the bravery is also simply in the objectification of the woman. So they don't regard, they did not ever consider the woman's will, where she wants to be with them or not. So completely objectifying, you want this woman, take it. You want this woman, take it. Like that is the kind of, you know, practice being preached and done by the incarnation of the Supreme Being, Krishna. So Ambedkar highlights this, and therefore Ambedkar rejects Mahabharat as a source of morality. Everybody talks about Mahabharat to be, you know, source of morality and teaching of moral, you know, moral laws. So we see that when there is a dehumanization and objectification of women, then this is against the principles of ethics. And when this is against the principles of ethics, then how can this be a source of morality? So it is invalid as a source of morality. That is what Ambedkar's you know, contribution to you know, pointing out how these practices are still revered in today's time, and how these are very, very harmful for the humankind, and not only for women. So yeah, so critique of Manusmriti, then he goes to criticize Manusmriti, and we all know that he has burned Manusmriti. So why? We see, so Manu, now Ambedkar says, Manu can hardly be said to be more tender to women than he was to Shudra. We all know what Manu used to think, and you know, the principles and the laws he had made for Shudras. So he was not even, you know, he was not treating women better than Shudras. So it's like same, Shudra and the woman both were regarded as slaves in the Manusmriti. So for Manu does not prevent a man from giving up his wife. So Manu is okay if a man wants to give up his wife, but what he does is to prevent can never become the legitimate wife of another who may have bought or received her after she was repudiated. So if, and then, so this is what the, you know, social system was, that culture was at the time of Manu, and which had been also, you know, encouraged and, you know, seen with great, you know, respect, that this is how a woman should be in the society. So now Ambedkar says, if this is not monstrous, nothing can be. But Manu was not worried by consideration of justice or injustice by his law. So Manu ensured women's slavery. Indeed, he declared a rule that killing a woman is mere upapattaka, that is a minor offense. That is from Manusmriti 11, sloka 67, that, you know, killing a woman is just normal. And then Manu says, women have no knowledge of religion because they don't have the right to know the Vedas. So we see how circular this argument is. First, he says that women do not have the right to know the Vedas, and because they do not have the right, they do not know the, you know, they do not have the knowledge of religion, and women cannot utter the Veda mantras because they are unclean, as untruth is. That is Manusmriti 9th, shloka number 18. So first, you are preventing women, you are prohibiting women to learn about Vedas, and then you say that they don't know Veda, and that is why they are unclean and untruth, you know, unclean as untruth is, like a lie, how lie is disgusting. Similarly, women are disgusting, and why? Because they don't have the knowledge of Veda. But But why they don't have the knowledge of Veda, that is not taken into consideration. Like, first you have denied them the right, spiritual right, and then they say that you are really bad because you don't know anything about spirituality. So Ambedkar regards this woo of woman as an insult and an injury to the women of India. So Ambedkar shows that Manu's argument is circular because firstly, a woman is prohibited to realize her spiritual potentiality, and then she is declared to be barren of spiritual potentiality. So since there had been people who had been arguing while I was doing this work that, how Ambedkar's feminism, is theoretically or philosophically relevant or how sound it is. So that is why quickly I would just offer a comparison to understand that the level of Ambedkar's feminist thought was no less than the prominent feminist figures of, of the world. So his feminist vision was no less than of Simone de Beauvoir. And we all know Simone de Beauvoir's The Second Sex book is well famous, and everybody talks about it whenever that, feminism begins from that. And we see that Ambedkar had written much, apart from Simone de Beauvoir's conceptualization, but similar argument is also made in Simone de Beauvoir's work. So in Second Sex, Beauvoir writes, a woman is shut up in a kitchen or a boudoir, and one is surprised her horizon is limited. Her wings are cut, and then she's blamed for not knowing how to fly. So similarly, Ambedkar is saying that, first you do not let women to realize their spiritual potentiality, and then you say that they are barren of the spiritual potentiality. So then Beauvoir says, let a future be open to her, and she will no longer be obliged to settle in the prison. So thus, seeing this kind of contradictory rules and regulations and how the objectification and degradation or even murders of women had been, regarded as a normal thing. That is why Ambedkar ended up burning Manusmriti on December 25th, 1927, which we all know is celebrated annually as Mahila Mukti Divas, that is Women's Liberation Day. So we can see that Ambedkar's feminist perspective is no less feminist than of Simone de Beauvoir. And he argues that women had no less intellectual potential than men by citing Buddhist literature like Patanjali's Mahabhashya and Kautilya's Arthashastra, wherein women possessed property and rights to knowledge pre-Manu time. And rights to knowledge, divorce, claim, maintenance, remarry, and men were charged abundant fine and punishment if they remarry for the desire of son without waiting for 8 to 10 years. So he is offering empirical evidence to the feminist discourse to argue that what Manu said is not logically sound, because in the previous time in the history, before Manusmriti, there was a time where women had all the rights and women had all the potentialities, even spiritual potentiality and property, and they were no less than men. So that is Ambedkar's, strong commitment to feminist, discourse, feminist thinking and feminist philosophy. So Ambedkar highlights from the very basic humanitarian grounds that Rama must have considered at least the physical and psychological troubles Sita would go through in advanced stage of pregnancy when he again sends Sita in the, Vanavas, like that 14-year time, or when Sita actually gives birth to Lav and Kush. So Ambedkar had been, thinking from a perspective, feminist perspective, that, even at least from the medical grounds or from being a king of a place as a citizen of your, you know, one's kingdom, one should consider that a woman in advanced pregnancy needs some kind of support or at least a prior notice without sending her away in the jungle. So this thing, and also that, you know, how Mahabharata dehumanizes women. So these are the, you know, these are the aspects and the exact actions and the rules which I think led Ambedkar to frame Hindu court bill. Because, you know, how women have been disregarded and they had got they had been snatched, robbed of the rights and dignity. So that is why I think Ambedkar had formed a Hindu court bill. So the basis of his pragmatic feminist vision is actually that all actually lies in the his feminist philosophy. So that is what I would like to now talk about a little bit. So we all know that Ambedkar said that, you know, he saw women as agents of social change and development. And he said that I measure the progress of a community by the degree of progress which women have achieved. So, and he advocates that unity is meaningless without the accompaniment of women. Education is meaningless without, you know, education is fruitless without educated women, and agitation is incomplete without the strength of women. So we know that Ambedkar's slogan was educate, agitate, and organize. So now he is highlighting that how in his slogan and how is in Ambedkarite mission, women's participation is a crucial, you know, aspect which we must include or must incorporate. And that is why he said unity is meaningless without women, education is fruitless without women, agitation is incomplete without the strength of women. And then he also says that let each girl who marries stand up to her husband, claim to be her husband's friend and equal, and refuse to be his slave. So, and introducing, okay, that I would go later. So Dr. Ambedkar, we see that how, you know, he has altered the position of woman, at least in, you know, in his Hindu court writing, his frame, which had taken some time to be practiced in society, but it came from his feminist philosophy. So he saw that how women were regarded as property. We see in Ramayana and also in, you know, in Mahabharata and in Manusmriti, where women could be given away by a husband but could never become a legitimate wife of another. So how they were regarded as a property, and with Hindu Succession Act, they became women with the property. So, you know, that is how Ambedkar's all this intellectual theoretical philosophy had got into the pragmatic philosophy, where he is altering the position of women. So earlier they were treated as slaves to their husbands, and now they had the power to stand up with their husbands, and then with so many maternity laws and other things, they could actually, you know, stand against any kind of injustice or offense against them. So earlier they had no right to education, and now we know that women with the fundamental right to education and the implementation of this right led women to not only be educated but also to educate others. And we know that in current time, many the profession of teaching is mostly filled with, you know, women. So introducing maternity bill, Ambedkar emphasizes that it is in the interest of the nation that mother ought to get a certain amount of rest in prenatal period. So so what he is doing is not to favor women. What he is doing is to, you know, improve our society, improve the nation, and make every individual and the citizen to be strong and healthy and educated. So that shows the profoundness of his vision for the future of the country. So we know that it is very basic, biological, that if a woman is not getting good rest or good nutrition during pregnancy, then the child born or a citizen going to be born will not be, you know, strong enough to contribute to the society ultimately. So the proposal, and then the proposal of feminist laws, that is Marriage Act, Maternity Act, Divorce and Maintenance Act, Adoption Act, etc., and it's on its opposition in Constituent Assembly, resigning from the position of law minister, shows that Ambedkar was strongly committed to avail equality to each and every woman of India, irrespective of caste, class, region, and religion, identities. So he did not focus on only Dalit women. He wanted each and every woman to be uplifted and empowered to be able to contribute to our country's development and progress. So he was seeing everybody, all the women, as a potential contributor to a better nation. And that is why he was really concerned about, you know, how patriarchy is, you know, mistreating women. So that is he has done. And Sharmila Rege argues, like a feminist of the political scientist writer who was the first person to actually highlight Ambedkar's feminist thought. So Sharmila Rege argues that Hindu code bill advances a woman to be recognized as an equal and free individual citizen as men, rather than less than a member of a family or something to be grained or protected, like how we regard women as honor or izzat. So that is less than a member, that is simply izzat or honor, whatever, but not as equal member of the family. So Hindu code helps a woman to be recognized as an equal and free individual citizen. So that, and then I would talk briefly about how, you know, Ambedkar's feminist commitment had been questioned by Savarna women. So can I take 10 more minutes?
Yes, you can. Go ahead.
Okay. Thank you. So so we see that how Ambedkar's feminist contribution had been, there had been attempts to, you know, belittle Ambedkar's contribution. So first is there, it is said that, one very interestingly, you know, there had been critics of Ambedkar's contribution, and it offers some joy while working on this, but at the same time also we see the ironies of feminist discourse in India, that how they read something and then they don't read the half of the same sentence. So that's what I'm looking for, that sentence which I had written, which I had quoted. One is contemporary third feminist writers. Yes, Ambedkar, Savarna feminists criticized that Ambedkar disdained some women by calling them shame to community on the grounds that when Ambedkar was giving a lecture, and he said that, you know, he says that profession which eventually leads you into disgraceful profession. So that was like he was addressing the woman who from Kamathipura, we know Kamathipura is a place in Maharashtra where most of the women there are so-called sex workers. So he was addressing those women and he was saying that, you know, work harder or do anything, but try to get out of this disgraceful life, which eventually, which that is what I was saying, that he said that, he also said that it is a shame to the community that you are doing this work. So many of the Savarna feminists say that Ambedkar disgraced those women by calling them a shame to community. But they did not see that in what context Ambedkar was using those words. So Savarna feminists say that Ambedkar was trying to, trying to make decisions for the women and not giving them freedom to choose what they want to do. Instead, Ambedkar is taking away their freedom and telling that I am telling you this and you do what I'm telling you. So Ambedkar being paternalistic or authoritative, that is the blame by Savarna feminists. So I would want to bring into everyone's notice that Ambedkar in the same speech, said that do not live under conditions which inevitably drag you into prostitution. So when we are criticizing Ambedkar for one speech where he's calling women as shame to community, we also need to see that how Savarna feminists ignored, one line in the same speech where he said that do not live under the condition. So he is highlighting the condition which inevitably drags women into prostitution. So he was referring to traditional practices where, the caste ordained linkage is there with the sexuality and labor. So the traditional practices of Devadasi, Murli and Jogini, we all know that, it was there where Dalit women, young Dalit girls were given away to priests and temples and then they were sexually exploited apart from offer all kind of services to them, like being a slave or a service woman to them, making food or cleaning their clothes or cleaning after the temple and taking care of everything. Along with that, they were also sexually exploited by the priest. And that is why they were called Devadasi. Dasi is slave and Dev is God. So slaves of the God, because the priests were treating them as slaves and also as sexual slaves. So he is talking about those traditional practices when he's saying that, stay away from this kind of situation where you would be dragged into prostitution, because these practices led Dalit women majorly into the business of prostitution. So he was highlighting that, and then his work also, like the same context had been highlighted by Rege, that subordinate caste women live life of exploitation, which is less than ideal lives in a more than imperfect milieu. So Ambedkar's appeal to them was to introspect into their humiliation, as an epistemological act, and to express their perspective to their oppressor is a political act. So Ambedkar was not disdaining them. Ambedkar was actually encouraging them to introspect, and which will be, introspect within yourself, that how a situation is putting into the condition, how some practice or, the surrounding or the, people in power or the caste privileged people are putting into conditions where you are humiliated. So you need to introspect into the humiliation and then also assert your perspective, express your perspective that I am no one to be treated like a slave. That would be a political act. So Ambedkar was encouraging them for an epistemological act, introspection within themselves, and also a political act to, express our assertive identity to the oppressor. And that was one. And then there was also a criticism from a Marxist feminist, Nivedita Menon, where she is criticizing Hindu court bills, some act, Hindu Succession Act. So she is saying that Hindu Succession Act nullified the better position of daughters under matrilineal laws, making sons equal inheritors. So she argues that, you know, the equalizing women's socioeconomic status under matrilineal practices with that of men's, so women cease to enjoy higher position than men. So we need to see that whether this criticism hold, because first we know that matrilineal practices are not pan India tradition. It is in some part of the India where matrilineal practice is there, and women have authority, but we also know that, you know, from contemporary scholarship, that mostly, yes, women get the property in their names, but only for the namesake, and you know, their husbands control how it is channelized and how it is used, and all the power lies in the husband's hand or like the brother's hand, like that it happens. Well, even if that is, you know, this not considered, even then we need to see that if a woman is getting equal right in the property as a man, or if a man is getting equal right in property as a woman, that is what we want for the gender justice and gender equality. That is what we call gender justice, gender equality, right? Equality means we have to treat everyone equally, and not that treat women as goddess or, you know, men as somebody who is slave. So that would be really problematic. So I would argue that making sons equal inheritors of the property of mother should not be seen as disempowering daughters, because if we are seeking gender justice, we must avoid such paths or steps which do injustice to men, you know. So that is why Ambedkar sought to equalize the rights and not to make men, you know, needy at the end. So in the same line of debate, Sharmila Rege says that the bill seeks to maintain an equality of position between the son and the daughter. So that, in other words, Ambedkar attempts to equalize the economic status of men and women by Hindu Succession Act, which is a necessary step to end gender injustice. So these are the two broad critiques of Ambedkar's feminist vision, that first he was calling women shame to the community, and second that he gave the equal right to the men of the of the India, where also in the societies where matrilineal was in practice. So we need to see that how Ambedkar's feminist understanding was so crucial and so profound, that he saw that how sexuality is linked with the caste, and how this equalizing the economic status of men and women was necessary, and not keeping anyone in the position where they have a bad economic or social status. And in the context of sex work, I want to just iterate this line written by Rege, that in the context of sex work, we all need to keep in mind that caste determines the division of labor in our society, and sexual division of labor, and the division of sexual labor. So it's not that one has a choice to decide whether they want to be a prostitute or not. Actually, caste system pushes women into the situations where they are left with no options than, you know, becoming a sexual slave to the people who have money, and the people who are caste privileged, and the people who regard women as slave or sexual slave. So I think with that note, I would want to end this presentation. And while there are so many things which we could discuss in the question answer session, and thank you everyone for your patience hearing, and thank you Dada and Boston Study Group for offering me this opportunity to present my work. And this is an article which is published now in the as chapter 4 in the Gender and Racial Justice by Oxford University Press. So I would share the link soon. I would upload it on my Academia page, and I would share the link on my social media so you all can read whatever I had just spoken, and you can use it in your discussions, debates, or academic work. So which this comes from my MPhil, that was Ambedkar as a Feminist Philosopher. So thank you everyone.
Thank you so much, Sunanya, for such an enriching talk. And as a Ambedkarite, I also learned a lot, which I think so I failed to understand it from feminist lenses. And Babasaheb being a multidimensional personality and a authority of many, this thing, sometimes we tend to not reach that level of his enlightened or his academic way. So thank you so much. And you have run us through like his various perspectives, various thoughts on from like Rama until you have even mentioned the last sentence which you concluded was a new learning for me. Although I have worked with female sex workers and all that for 2 to 3 years, I never understood this caste dimension of that. Thank you so much for my even adding to my personal learning and gain. So saying this, well, like instead of me asking question, I would first of all invite participants. If you have any question, please, you can raise your hand. And otherwise, if you don't feel to ask, you can type your question in the chat so that I can read it for Sunanya. And also people who are listening on Facebook and YouTube, please, you can type your questions and our team will forward it to me. So if there is anyone who wants to ask question, can you please raise your hand?
Dada sir, there is a question in chat box.
Okay, great. By Amit Kumar, yes. So the first question is, as we all know that Ambedkar was the person who worked for the emancipation and empowerment of women, do you think that in this caste-ridden society, upper caste women recognize this?
I go one by one, like by one question, or should we collect? However you say, or maybe till we get next question, I could respond to this one.
You can go ahead with that. Yeah, that is a good idea.
Yeah. So thank you, Amar. And thank you, Dr. Anwar. I didn't know Dr. Anwar from Monmouth University is also attending this talk. Thank you, you. And thanks, everybody. So thanks, Amit, for your question. Upper caste women, that is why there's a lot of critique going on into this time in the feminist discourse that since 1992, the Durban conference, when, you know, Dalit women had actually got agitated and said that, you know, you don't understand the issues of Dalit women. So not only the issues of Dalit women, but also Ambedkar's contribution is not well recognized by the Savarna woman. And that is why I think we all need to critique the mainstream ways of doing feminism, and I'm trying to do that. So like in this book, Dalit Feminist Theory, this book is entirely on that, like, you know, how what mainstream Savarna feminists are doing wrong, and how can we find that, how can we find a way to resolve the problems of our society. So that I agree with you that this is not. How do you think the scholarship of Ambedkar is relevant within the trans third sex people in yes, Anwar, should I go, Dada? You're mute.
Questions.
Okay. So
sorry, you can go ahead. Read, I will read the question, so I will that responsibility. So we have multiple questions now. So I can ask you a couple of questions so that we can answer them together. So Anwar, they ask, how do you think the scholarship of Ambedkar is relevant when we think of trans, third sex people in thinking of feminist philosophy? And this is the another question is by Amar. How is Ambedkar's idea of women emancipation different from feminist and Marxist perspective? So these two, you should take these two questions together because they need a lot of, I think so.
Thank you, Amar. He's from Nepal and doing PhD at Pittsburgh. I'm happy that you are attending this, Amar. Thank you. So yes, your question is really interesting, and how it is different from the feminist, from the, you know, Ambedkarite feminist perspective. Sorry, Ambedkar's idea of women's participation different from feminist and Marxist perspective. So mostly, you know, the feminist discourse in South Asia is led by the Marxist, mostly Marxist or liberal, this feminist who regard class as the crucial, identity for every individual. And that is how they fail to see how class is also a byproduct of the caste system in our society. So Ambedkar's feminist perspective takes that into consideration. And that is why we like Ambedkarite feminism does not exclude any woman, like, you know, Marxist or liberal or mainstream Savarna feminists, they exclude the issues of Dalit woman. And many of the times, even in the conferences, that they say that it is your problem, right? It is your problem. Like, gender is our problem. We will fight it together. Especially in the activist and, you know, the activist organization, that they say that, well, gender is our collective problem, but caste is your problem. So you better deal with it your way. So that is something which, you know, is very crucially different. And as I have discussed on the issue of sex work, that, you know, Marxist and liberal feminists see it from a different angle. They see it from the Western, you know, perspective that, okay, everybody has the right to choose and one can decide what they want to choose. And even in the Western world, we know that how race actually determines the sexual labor and the sexual, slavery. So, similarly, the perspective of caste in India is missed out by the Marxist and the liberal feminist, and that is why Ambedkarite feminist is, or I also call it Dalit feminist, because it is keeping the question of caste at its core is Dalit feminism. So, which is not a feminism for Dalits or by Dalits, it is a feminism for patriarchy, which is Brahmanical. So, like, you know, how caste is inherently linked with the gender. So that is how it is different. And Dr. Anwar, thank you for your question. How is Ambedkar scholarship relevant with the trans and third sex people in the feminist philosophy? So I wish I had worked extensively on this. I couldn't, but I want to take this up later in my scholarship. And in fact, Akhil Kang, he is a student of anthropology, PhD student anthropology in the US. Mm. I'm forgetting Dada, do you remember which university he's at?
I think so. He's at Princeton.
No. I've got that one. So Akhil is primarily working on that. And I have learned from his, work that Ambedkar, since he was, his basic principles of were equality, liberty, and fraternity, which is actually metta or maitri, that is the love for your love and compassion for the fellow human being. Then from his basic principles, we could see that Ambedkar was always pro-marginalized. So anyone who is more marginalized based on sexuality, gender, caste, class, or religion, then he needed more upliftment in order to have equal, participation for the, not only equal participation, but to treat them as equal citizen. So from that angle, I would say, yes, but the scholarship of Ambedkar had not been developed that much as on women question, as on the trans question. So I would really want to learn more, and I would in fact send you something about from Akhil Kang. So that would be helpful. Thank you.
Sarita has typed Akhil is at Cornell. Yes, Shashwati.
Yes, Akhil is Cornell University Anthropology. Yes.
Yes. Now, next question. I'm taking it from YouTube. Is Panthera. He asked that how to inculcate more women into the movement, since many of the women are easily trapped in superstition. So I will take one more question. This is from Avinash. Do you believe that Ambedkar is a pioneer of right-based feminism in India, though Phule immensely contributed for the very discourse of feminism?
Okay. Thank you, Avinash, and thank you, Sanjay. Panthera, for your questions. I would take the first one first. Panthera, you are saying that women are mostly easily trapped in superstition. So how to include more women in the movement? So one, we need to see that how and what are the situations and conditions which led women into more superstition. So we know that mostly the household and the rules and regulations of the inside the house is given to the women, and that is why we also see that the touchability and untouchability is mostly taken care by the women in the society, and that is why they are easily trapped into the superstition. But it's not like, it's again an empirical claim you're making that they are easily trapped. Maybe that is true, maybe that is not true, because one is that not all women are in the same situation and condition, and also I think the patriarchal understanding in our society does not help women to realize their rational potential. So reasoning and logic, they are mostly shut on the topics of mathematics, logic, science, reasoning, and said that, well, you are emotional beings and you don't know the science and the reasoning things. So that is one kind of understanding we have, and based on that, women are often not encouraged to get higher education or to get education which helps them develop their own independent identity and to challenge and criticize things at everyday life. So I think we need to make our society and community, or even our house, more encouraging for the woman to become independent and to become to participate in the things which are reasoning or calculations, those things. So it's not that we cannot just blame them. It's like they are trapped into superstition, so we cannot bring them in the movement. That is also our responsibility as a society, to help them and help everybody to, and also to make our own movement more women friendly, because many of the time we see that many of the women are getting sexist comments in the movements itself, and the comments like you are worthless, you can't be equal to us, and the leadership positions are not given to them in the organizations. That is proven already. So we need to work on two levels, individually and collectively. So that's how we have to understand the goal of Ambedkar, right? Feminism, Ambedkarism. What Ambedkar said, that unity is meaningless without women. So we have to take the hard work, do the hard work to work on that. And Avinash, do you really believe that Ambedkar is pioneer of right-based feminism in India, though Phule immensely contributed to the very discourse of feminism? Well, I would not say that Ambedkar's or Phule's contribution is less than the other, like less or more as compared to each other, because I see them together. How Phule's feminist philosophy had been taken forward by Ambedkar. That is how I see. So Phule did the things in theory and in practice which were required at that point of time, and Ambedkar also did the same things, and both of them and their thought is relevant even today, and it will remain relevant till our country does not become really progressive and just and egalitarian. So Phule was also in a way availing rights and dignity to the women, like opening the house for widows and starting remarriage of the widows, and also starting education for women. Those were also the acts where they were Phule couple, Savitribai Phule and Mahatma Phule, both were trying to help women to get the right to education and right to dignity and right to equality, right? So that was also very much right based, not less than Ambedkar. So, and also on Ambedkar, I don't think I can say that Ambedkar's contribution was not in the discourse of feminism. So just that we had been ignorant for so many years that we could not see Ambedkar was contributing immensely to the feminist discourse. So thank you.
Thank you. I will read out the next question. It is by Shweta Singh. She says, what has been the most common criticism of Ambedkar's idea of feminism, especially by contemporary feminist scholars?
Okay, so should I take it?
Yeah, you can take it.
Yeah. So most common criticism is one, which I had mentioned, that on sexuality, that Ambedkar had not been able to see the woman's freedom, sex work, sorry, from the lens of the freedom and freedom of choice. And the other one is like Hindu Succession Act had, nullified the higher economic status of women in the matrilineal societies. And then there are it is being said based on these two broadly comments that Ambedkar was not feminist enough. So that is the very common thing which is said. And also one criticism is that he was taking care of his education and his own identity and his charisma, but not taking care of his wife, or like based on his personal life. That is what is being talked about. But I have it's something which requires some more time. So I would just say that I have discussed this in the chapter. I've discussed this in chapter 5 of this book chapter 6 of this book especially discusses like how the relationship between Ramabai and Ambedkar was egalitarian and was feminist. So to counter the critique of the personal that he was not he was patriarchal, he was practicing patriarchy in a way, because from this, that is Sharmila Regis chapter 6 in this book, where she's mentioning about how Ambedkar had been always encouraging and supportive and helped her to learn and make your independent decision. So that is what I would say is one of the other ignorant comment on Ambedkar's feminism. So yeah, I think that's what I would say now.
Thank you. Should we go for next questions?
Yes, sure.
Yeah, this is from Daya, Aruna, sorry. And she asked, what is the difference between Dalit feminism and Ambedkarite feminism?
Okay.
Should I ask one more question? This is also, I think, so relevant by Sangeeta. She asked, how can we see Ambedkar's feminist philosophy towards tribal women in India?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you. Shwet Aruna, right? Aruna and Daya Aruna, and who's the second person? Sangeeta, yes. Thank you, Sangeeta and Aruna, for asking this question and also for attending this talk. So how, first I would go on, you know, how Ambedkar's feminist philosophy could help or could be related to tribal women in India. So I think had Ambedkar have got some more years of life, he would be surely working on the tribes of India and also on, you know, the minorities of India. So I think like that, having that said, I would say that, you know, Ambedkar's core philosophy of, you know, how one is treated because of what kind of mainstream or popular narrative is there in the society. So based on that, he is pro the people who are being mistreated, and his agenda is always to avail or help the society to avail equality, dignity, and justice to each and every person. So that's how he would also do for the tribal community and tribal feminism. At the same time, I have not, you know, I have not researched enough about Ambedkar's contribution to tribal feminism myself. So I would like to take this up later. Thank you. And Aruna, your question is interesting. And at the same time, I think this is becoming a kind of debatable topic among Ambedkarites.
Right. So there is one, like connecting this thing by Birda. I will just read that for you so that it will be easier for you to answer. Do you understand Ambedkarite thoughts? Should we start using phrases like Ambedkarite feminist versus Dalit feminist? So it could be like easier for you to answer.
Thank you, Venkat, for your question. I think anything, you know, anything which is created by agony, or which might lead into agony or any kind of division, must not be encouraged. So like if we are using the word versus, you know, so versus is similar, like, you know, what is it which is crucial for Dalit feminism and crucial for Ambedkarite feminism is that equality and justice and dignity to each and everyone, right? So why do we want to use the term versus? So as I see it, well, Ambedkar did not use feminism itself in his writing. So how can we say that, you know, so when people are criticizing that Ambedkar did not use Dalit feminism, so we should not use the term Dalit feminism. But at the same time, Ambedkar did not even use the word feminism, but still we want to use Ambedkarite feminism. So, and Dalit feminism, why do I use Dalit feminism is because Dalit is not only the literal meaning, of course, is not very dignified, but at the same time, Dalit is also a term of assertion. And in the contemporary context, actually, Dalit is used as assertion. And the international world actually knows the Dalit as an empowerment category, right, Dada? It is seen as a category of empowerment and people who are fighting for their rights and justice. So it is not a humiliating term, like as Harijan is. We know that how Harijan is used, like for mostly Hari is like a god and Jan is people. So how Harijan is also related with the practices of Devadasi, that the women who were sexually exploited by the priest produced the children which were called as Harijan. So how, you know, a Devadasi's child is called Harijan, and how that term is so, you know, degrading for Dalit community of our society. So Dalit, the term Dalit is not like Harijan. So it's not that I also don't understand, like, why there is so much pushing about, you know, a word. Like, whatever we do, or action, or thinking, or belief, that matters more than, you know, the debates around the word. So, of course, it is not like, you know, Marxist and liberal, because that is their defining terms. And here, if we use Ambedkarite or Dalit, it is not that opposite like Marxist and liberal and Dalit and Ambedkarite. So we have to be focused on why do we need it? Why do we need feminism? Why do we need feminism for everybody? So I think Ambedkarite feminism is same as Dalit feminism, just that many of the people are uncomfortable using the term Dalit feminism, while people who are Dalit feminists, who call themselves Dalit feminism, are not against the term Ambedkarite feminism, because Ambedkarite feminism is a kind of seed for Dalit feminism, you know. So we might not want to use the word Dalit, but at the same time, Dalit feminism cannot be seen without Ambedkar's contribution to it. So I don't believe into this kind of, you know, division or opposition. In fact, I would say that what Ambedkar stood for and what we want to stand for, that is what matters most than the terminology. And sometimes, like my feeling, like sometimes I also feel that maybe these kinds of confusion are also created by the mainstream or caste privileged people, because they don't know or experience, they don't know what is it to be a Dalit, they don't know what is it to be an indigenous person, they don't know what is it to be a minority person, they don't know what is it to be a person from the, you know, not from the mainland. And that is why they get so much engrossed around the terminology, and because they have the higher the major population in the at the positions of authority, they are confused around the terminology, and they also want us to be confused about the terminology, while we know that our experience, our lives, our stories matter. So we should be focusing on that, and it's a term of preference. Maybe we want to use Ambedkarite, we want to use Dalit, whatever. I use Dalit because Dalit is Dalit uses the, you know, Dalit articulates the aspect of caste which has been ignored to differentiate between the mainstream and the feminism, which is all encompassing, not for only Savarna women, but for everybody. And Ambedkarite feminism is the same. It was for every woman, not for, you know, not for only Savarnas. So, but at the same time, Ambedkarite feminism can also be seen as the women movement at the Ambedkarite time. So historically, yes, Ambedkarite feminism was there, but at the current time, Dalit feminism is also used, but it is not in opposition to Ambedkarite feminism. I'm sorry, I've taken too long on this, but I hope I've said my point that, you know, what we do matters more than the terminology, and we have the stories and our experiences. So we should focus on that, the shared experiences, shared lives, than terminology, which is a business maybe for the Savarnas.
Great. So we have another question by Amit. So do you think that we are lacking in Dalit feminism because we don't have much scholars to raise voice through Dalit literature in India? And he, in bracket, he writes, correct me if I'm wrong.
Thank you, Amit, for this query. I don't think we are lacking in Dalit feminism because we don't have scholar to raise voice or Dalit literature, because there's vast amount of Dalit literature present in the, you know, in our society. And many of them are currently, like in last decade or so, has been also translated into English. So it is accessible for everybody. So there's lots and lots of Dalit literature present. And if we say that there is less literature, well, that might be less literature in Dalit feminism by the Dalit woman, maybe. But still, it is there. It is not like we don't have. So we have. So why are we lacking in Dalit feminism? One, because the mainstream, if we see the feminist discourse, they always sideline the caste matter, the matters of caste, right? And similarly, if we see the Ambedkarite discourse, the people after Ambedkar and Phule and Periyar are actually sidelining the matters of gender. So that is why it is intersectional. So Ambedkarites do not take into consideration patriarchy as equal to caste, and feminists do not take into consideration casteism as equal to patriarchy. So I think that is why we are lacking in Dalit feminism, not because there is less literature. So we have to have commitment for this intersectional marginalization of Dalit women. Also, the reason is primary Brahminical patriarchy. So because the patriarchy works according to the caste hierarchy, that is graded inequality, and that is why we need Dalit feminism. So, and everything else is a effect of Brahminical patriarchy, that we are not considering the gender question as well as the caste question together. So yeah, thanks.
Yeah, so we have one more very big question from my younger sister. So she writes, Sunanda ma'am, that was an eye-opening and highly insightful discourse. Thank you for all the tireless work that goes into your research in this area. My question, on one hand, Savarna feminists continue to relegate Dalit Bahujan feminists to the peripheries. On the other hand, Dalit men have, on many occasions, have denied Dalit Bahujan feminist the leading position in any movement. Professor Gopal Guru in Dalit Women Speak Differently talks about how Dalit Bahujan feminists are accused of being divisive by the Dalit Bahujan community itself. How does this do justice to Babasaheb's tireless work as one of the pioneering of intersectional feminism, and how can this be addressed in the current time? How do young Dalit women navigate this selective Ambedkarite politics in academic spaces?
Great, thank you. This is a very comprehensive question, and I think what we need to begin with is to understand Brahminical patriarchy, the nature of patriarchy, which is Brahminical, and see how the, you know, how does it function? How does it operate? So like Ambedkar's work, caste in India, it's about origins, mechanisms, and, you know, how it is working in the society. Caste system. So similarly, Brahminical patriarchy, we need to understand everything about Brahminical patriarchy. Like, okay, Brahminical patriarchy gives the highest position of authority and power to Brahmin men, but under the Brahmin men, there is the Brahmin woman, but the Brahmin woman is actually having the authority over even Rajput men. So, you know, how the gender inequality works, and how, like, there is also this concept of so-called Dalit patriarchy, where they say that the Dalit men, are being humiliated based on caste angle in our society, and that is why they behave aggressively to their women in their houses. So I would say on that if Dalit men are being humiliated based on caste, that is also that is also explained by the concept Brahminical patriarchy or graded patriarchy, as Ambedkar has used the, like, has called it. So even if a man, well, it is not established that Dalit men are more aggressive or anything empirically. So it is an empirical claim which has no empirical evidence. And I have discussed it elaborately on my article, Dalit or Brahminical Patriarchy. So even if Dalit men are humiliated and that is why they behave more aggressively, then also the humiliation is because of the caste system. So we cannot call that Dalit men or Dalit community is primarily responsible for their behavior, their patriarchal behavior. In fact, it is the Brahminism which is responsible for the Dalit women's oppression by the Dalit men. So I think these are the nuances which we need to understand first about the Brahminical patriarchy, and then we need to think about the ways and the methods and approaches, and collectively work towards annihilating Brahminical patriarchy. So when we moved forward collectively in that direction, then yes, I think then we can hope to have a better future for everybody. And at the same time, I've also have to deal with the challenges which are put forward by the Savarna feminist and the challenges by put forward by the patriarchal so-called Ambedkarites. Well, I would say, because I has also been part of activist organizations, Ambedkarite organization, and I see and I use that, you know, don't call yourself Ambedkarite if you are patriarchal. So for me, if you claim to be an Ambedkarite, then you have to be gender sensitive and you have to be, believing in equality, no matter what caste, even the internal caste hierarchy and the gender and the class, all of that we have to, keep in our minds all the time, in every speech, in every action, at every day, that we are not following casteism, we are not following racism, we are not following patriarchy, we are not following homophobia, these kinds of things. We have to actively engage in the Ambedkarite vision for our future, and that is how we can move in the correct direction. So that is what I think I would like to say now, and maybe we could have further discussion later sometime. Thanks.
Yes, we have one question or comment, like personally, mm-hmm. your comment on like Facebook. So, Dalip. So, Dalip asks or says that, are you aware that Baba Saheb Ambedkar used to discuss the issue of women rights during drafting of Hindu Code Bill with Satyabala, daughter of Puran Chand, who was close confidant and associate of Baba Saheb? Satyabala aired her views for equal status and freedom for women who were suffering under the patriarchal system. So he's expecting your comment. He says, comment, please.
Oh, great. Thank you. No, I did not know that he was discussing this, with Satyabala's daughter. So thank you for bringing this into my, knowledge. And I would like to know more about it. Maybe I'll have to... I'll have to reread the drafting of Hindu Code Bill, so he might have put that there. So thank you.
So Avinash asks one more question. He writes, can you elaborate about class aspect in Dalit feminism?
Thank you, Avinash, for this question. So yeah, class aspect in Dalit feminism. So first we need to understand how class is related with caste, because Dalit feminism is a feminism which takes into consideration at the caste aspect, that the caste-based discrimination at the center of feminist discourse. So we need to understand how class is related with caste. Economist Sukhdev Thorat's work is enormously engaging with this, this discussion, this discourse of class and caste. So based on his research and his evidences and the data, I would say that the class is actually determined by the caste, like how Dalits were denied of the right to property, right to education, and right to equality. So similarly, their property was snatched historically, like Dalit people's land had been robbed out by the Savarnas, and that is how Dalits mostly are poor in contemporary time. And so they said that you don't have right to property, and because you don't have right to property, so where did that property go? The property went to the hands of the upper caste people, so-called upper caste people. So that is how they ended up becoming poor, and because they did not have the right to education, they did not learn to, learn skills or gather knowledge where they could expand their economic economic resources. So that is also how they did not get an opportunity to build their economic resources. And then they did not have the right to equality. So yes, wage labors, the same Dalit person might do different works in like not in the government sector, but otherwise, Dalit person and other person would be doing the same work, but still the Dalit would be getting less, pay. That equal financial resource is not there. And also in the government sector and in the stable permanent jobs, we know that how Dalits, because of the discrimination and the exclusion, many of the Dalit people do not get promoted on time, and they are often put faced with hurdles in their job and their payment salary. So that is also why their economic status is not at par with, you know, the Savarnas and or even OBCs. So for example, you know, we know that, see how this our society is, we can see in our neighborhood, like if one person in a Savarna family is not having a permanent job, they feel poor. And if one person in a Dalit family gets a permanent job, then it is regarded as they became elite, right? So that is how we see that the class status works in our society, and it is really very much connected with the caste system. So that is how the class aspect also operates in the feminist discourse, that, you know, Savarna feminists mostly align the feminist discourse with the class status because, you know, they enjoy the caste privilege. So in order to question the caste system, they would have to give away the privilege they are enjoying because of their caste. So that is why they talk about class. And class, we know it is no something new, like something really separate from the caste system in our society. In fact, we all need to see that our society is actually caste-based organized and not class-based organized, unlike other countries, so mostly Western world. So that is why they talk about class, and they talk about freedom and choice and rights and everything as if everybody is on the you know, same status. Even, and we also know the example, see, there are IAFS officers, there are IAS officers, there are people in the highest authority, but still a peon would deny them the water. It happened with Dr. Ambedkar in his life, and it is still happening, that how they are treated badly. So the dignity has always been denied for to the Dalits, and humiliation and exploitation and exclusion is always there for the Dalits. So the class is completely related with the caste, and that is how we need to question the caste, and class would be taken care of it in itself. So, but at the same time, I'm not denying that there is class hierarchy among Dalits as well. So like, for example, see a woman who's a sex worker, so-called sex worker, and a woman who's a government officer, right? So there would be a class hierarchy between them. Maybe the woman in the being a government officer may be exploiting the Dalit woman working in her house, you know, as a household laborer. So that is also there, but that is among the caste, among the Dalits, you know, among the community. That is an internal matter, but class is not something based which divides communities at the mass level, like Brahmin, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra are not class, they are caste. So we need to, you know, see that it is related, but at the same time, what is our primary enemy is casteism and not capitalism. In India is, in fact, I say that, you know, I think that had Marx been born in India, he would do same as Ambedkar has done. So it's totally, you know, a kind of appropriation of whatever we see, like, or maybe ignorance, because many of the Savarna people who call themselves Marxists or so-called communists, they don't know the reality of Dalits. Like they have not experienced what it is to be a Dalit in our society. And that is why they, even if they want to help, even if they want to have a progressive society, they actually lack the experiential point of view, and that is why they are not able to contribute as much as Ambedkarite would do. So thank you
so much, Sunanya. There are a couple more points, like, are you, like, do you want to go ahead with that or?
Sure.
Yeah, wonderful. So before asking question, I find Venkardas comment interesting, or we can discuss or enhance our discussion on that. So I would read that, so that if you want to take ahead the discussion, we can go ahead. he writes like the reason between Savarna, the reason is why he is advocating for Ambedkar feminist phrase. So he writes the reason is between Savarna and Dalits. There are a spectrum of marginalized sections like tribals, OBC and religious minorities who are also to a great extent suppressed and marginalized. And Ambedkarism has so much relevance and can offer liberation for this section equally well.
Okay. Can you please repeat? I think I got a little lost. Like, is it about Ambedkar's relevance to the tribal and minorities, or?
Yeah, that's sort of like the reason is, his earlier question was, can we start using phrase Ambedkarite feminism instead of Dalit feminism? And he says the reason is because between Savarna and Dalits, there are spectrum of marginalized sections like tribes, OBCs, and religious minorities who are also to great extent suppressed and marginalized. And Ambedkarism has so much relevance and can offer liberation for these sections equally well.
Okay. Sorry to for asking you again, but thank you. Yes, I would agree with this argument. I am thinking that, yes, if that is the argument that, you know, Ambedkarism includes all the marginalized communities, then we could use Ambedkarite word. But at the same time, I don't see Dalit as excluding, you know, because Dalit is like, Dalit as a term, you know, propounded for equality, empowerment, egalitarianism is not excluding anyone. And Dalit, using the term Dalit, is not about Dalit communities when used in with the feminism or Dalit thought or Dalit philosophy or Dalit feminism. It is not, as I said, feminism by the Dalits or for the Dalits. It is a feminism which keeps into the consideration the marginalities, which is primarily caste in our society, but at the same time, how class and, you know, indigenous people are also, you know, discriminated based on the mainstream. So they are also suffering because of the Brahminical patriarchy. So Brahminical patriarchy is not hitting only Dalits, it is hitting everybody. So whoever, based on their location in the, you know, their caste strata. So caste and gender strata. So Dalit is not excluding because it is not a group of people with Dalit, who come from Dalit background, but Dalit is a standpoint, a belief, a principle, which is for equality, for empowerment, for upliftment, and for the collective progress of our society. So whoever is marginalized needs more support, needs more opportunities, positive discrimination, like reservation. So that is how I see Dalit is not exclusionary. So we can use that as well. While, again, I would say that, you know, terminology does not matter much. Then otherwise, we could also use the term, tribal people might like to say that I don't want feel like being included in the Ambedkar feminism. So I want to use tribal feminism. So, you know, this debate can go on and on. And then, you know, we also know that there is, like Tamar and Mahar, you know, debate all the time among Dalit discourse. So I feel that, you know, any, like the terminologies do not matter that much. What do we do? That is important. And as long as we keep each other's support, we are in solidarity with each other, and we see that Brahminical patriarchy is our common enemy, like the system of Brahminical patriarchy, then we can, you know, hope to have a better society together. So I don't see much of a point in, you know, in the, like, putting much time into the terminology discussion debate. Honestly, that's what I feel, but maybe I might get something really interesting which might be able to help me, you know, which might help me to think more thoroughly on that. So, but for now, I would submit this. Thanks. Okay. Sanjay, Ambedkarism is broader and more inclusive term than Dalit or Dalit. Okay. So, yeah, I would say the same what you just said, that yes, you might say Ambedkarism is, but then tribals might say no. And then, you know, there would be minorities saying no. So we cannot grant that this is more inclusionary or this is more exclusionary, because it depends how a community, how an individual feels at that time, like in that, you know, in the situation. So I would say Ambedkarism is not in rivalry with Dalit, or Dalitism, like Dalit term, is not in rivalry with Ambedkarism. So I would say that, you know, we should not think about, not see these two as very different or exclusionary. So that is what I would like to say for now.
So Sunaina, Sanjay here. So when we are talking about the Dalits and all this, so you have given the very different meaning to Dalit. So as far as we understand and the people around the world understand, it is specific to the caste. Means it is certain sections from the caste system who are considered as the Dalits. It is not, and that's why we always feel that all Dalits are not Ambedkar, and at the same time, all Ambedkarites are not Dalits. Okay, so in that term, if we wanted to include everybody, means if we want other peoples to endorse Ambedkar or accept Ambedkar, we have to go beyond the Dalits. So that is what is important. Otherwise, if we are just sticking that or calling every Ambedkarite as Dalit, That is what not go well with the people who wanted to be the part of the Ambedkarite movements, or who wanted to absorb the Ambedkarism or follow the Ambedkarism, because the Dalit is very specific term. Means in what way I want to explain to anybody outside that Dalit doesn't mean a specific caste, but it means something else, it will not go well. That is what is our observation.
Yes, I would not disagree with you, but in my context, what I'm saying, in Dalit feminism or Dalit philosophy, it is not philosophy or feminism of Dalit people, but it is, you know, it is keeping the caste into the center. But I agree with you that, you know, all Dalits are not Ambedkarite, and all Ambedkarites are not Dalits. Like Sharmila Rege was an Ambedkarite, but she wasn't Dalit. So in that, like, based on like when there is only one primary identity, that Dalit or Ambedkarite, then of course Ambedkarite is more inclusionary than Dalit. But when we are conceptualizing, then like Dalit theory or Ambedkarite theory or Ambedkarite feminism or Dalit feminism or philosophy, you know, Ambedkarite philosophy or Dalit philosophy, then I don't think there is much of the difference, you know. So because then it is not about a person's identity, caste identity or social identity, it is standpoint. So like it is ideology, like Ambedkarite is an ideology similarly. So but when there is only primary, when I call myself a Dalit feminist, well, there is two identity. One, feminist, and second, Dalit. Like not the Dalit person, but the standpoint. The Dalit becomes an adjective to my feminist discourse, or Ambedkarite becomes an adjective to my feminist discourse. In that context, I think there is not much difference. But when I say I am a Dalit or I am an Ambedkarite, then of course, not everybody who is a Dalit is an Ambedkarite, because we know there are Dalits who are also in the right-wing organizations, and there are also Ambedkarites who are not Dalit, who don't come from Dalit communities. So like I just said, Sharmila Rege, or there are people who are not even Indians. Many of the Black people are Ambedkarite. So yes, it is more inclusionary when there is only one identity we are talking about. But otherwise, I think when it is used as an adjective, it is not exclusionary. So, that is...
Miss, we fully understand. Yeah. If you are Dalit, and then you can use that adjective with anything else. But when we are talking about about the Ambedkarite thoughts, we should never think that from the perspective of the Dalits only, or the it is an Ambedkarite thought, that means it is a Dalit thought. I think we should avoid defining any Ambedkarite thought that way. Otherwise, we will get bogged down with, again, only those 25%. And even those 25% also don't accept the Ambedkar. There are very limited populations within the Dalits who accept the Ambedkar. So we have to be very careful what we are linking Ambedkar to. So that is what is our concerns.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah.
There is very interesting comment by Naveen. So he writes, Baba Sahib's article on felony of civilization touched fully DNT, Adivasi and Untouchable. Clarification clearly, nothing left out by Baba Sahib. So there are so many comments for you. So I will share that one. They are nice and encouraging one. So I'll send that to you for sure. And now this is, I was about to ask you and not ask you to discuss, but there is very interesting question by Mahadeva Swami, who writes, why don't we, there is another aspect now, why don't we use Bahujan and Bahujan feminism, which are more inclusive? Do you think this is workable project?
Wow, thank you. So that is what I was just trying to say, that this does not have an end. Like, if we talk about terminology, this doesn't have an end. So there would be a Ambedkarite feminism, there would be a tribal feminism, there would be a Dalit feminism, there would be Bahujan feminism, there would be, like, it doesn't have an end, right? Because our society is really, really, really diverse, and the marginalization of everybody is different, right? So, like, that is why I use the concept of difference and the framework of intersectionality, from which I am borrowing from Black feminist philosophers. So everybody has a different kind of experience in our society. So the discrimination and exclusion and the humiliation is also of the different kind for a tribal person. So similarly, for a Dalit person or a minority person or a person who's like a trans person, so disabled person as well, but that is not like an identity. It's a different part in the intersectional understanding. So this, the term Bahujan, I think many would not like to call themselves Bahujan, because Bahujan is, well, it has three connotations broadly, which I understand. Is one, that Bahujan all encompassing, that is Dalits, tribals, minorities, and people who are regarded as inferior or marginalized in our society. So yes, Bahujan for that. Second, Bahujan, which is used with the, like Kancha Alaiya. By Kancha Alaiya, he uses Dalit and Bahujan together without an hyphen. So he uses Dalit Bahujan because it says that the Dalits and the Bahujan, like the intermediate caste people, the middle caste people who were earlier Shudras, they all have to come together and work together fighting against Brahminical patriarchy. So that is Kancha Alaiya's conception. And second, Bahujan is like just Bahujan, which is used with a hyphen with the Dalit term. So there we see that the Bahujan is also understood as the term representing middle caste, like that is an intermediate caste, like who are Shudras. And because our society is diverse, and because Brahminical patriarchy operates in such a way that Bahujans had also been the tools of violence against Dalits used by the Savarnas. So in that terminology, a Dalit might feel offended when called a Bahujan in the terms of Shudras, because many of the Shudras had been oppressing Dalits. So, there are three terminology which I like, three connotations of the term Bahujan. So it becomes really complex. And so not everybody might like to be called Bahujan. And for me personally, I would support Bahujan, but at the same time, I would also assert that among the Bahujan, my experience being a Dalit woman is different. So yes, as in the broader context, when there is a mainstream and there is Bahujan politics, then yes, I am with the Bahujan politics. But among the Bahujan politics, I am a woman and I am a Dalit, because a Dalit woman is not equal to a Bahujan, like OBC woman. Her experience is different and my experience is different. So like, for example, so we'll have to really, maybe it's not possible, it doesn't seem possible that all the Ambedkarites and all the, you know, Bahujan people coming together and discussing and deciding what term do we want to be representing ourselves with. But I think we need to keep in our mind at the same time when we are using a particular term, then nobody's feeling should be hurt. Nobody should be feeling excluded or inferior. So that is, I think I would like to say that it is also a subjective understanding that we think it is more inclusive, but somebody might feel it is exclusionary or exclusionary for them. So so I think that is why terminology is good, important to represent, but at the same time, terminology, I think, takes out so much of energy and effort, which if we put into action, would yield more results. And yeah, so sorry, there was another question as well. Yeah, felony of civilization. Thank you, Naveen, for bringing that into notice for everyone here. I think I have read it, but not recently. So yes, I would like to read it again. And I would really highly recommend everybody to read this article by Dr. Ambedkar called Felony of Civilization, where he's discussed the tribal issues, denotified tribals and untouchable like classification. And we might have different interpretations of it. So because I've heard from a tribal person that he says that Ambedkar's writing on tribal is not satisfactory, right? So I think we'll need to look into that. And we know that, you know, everyone is different with the different privileges and power and authorities. So we need to be all exclusionary. We need to try to be all exclusionary as inclusionary as much as possible. So we should read and analyze, and we might find something more while reading Ambedkar. So yes, thank you.
Thank you so much, Sunanya. And first of all, I would like to appreciate your courage to take toughest question, which is right now going in the peripheries or academic area or discussions, and which is around Ambedkarites, Bahujans, and Dalit nomenclatures, and as you said, terminology. And I know this is very ongoing debate, and I appreciate your boldness that you took a stand and you spoke about it, and see the beauty of that inclusiveness. A person who is hosting this is has just pushed himself to the discussions or peripheries of from Dalit feminism to Ambedkarite feminism in his work or in his all papers and research, and hosting a person who has exclusively written on Dalit feminism and who has read a lot on Ambedkar's philosophy on that. So this is what the beauty of our like inclusive diaspora is, and I really feel proud of for being that. Instead of debating, we discuss this so that, and we respect each other's comments and discussions or standpoints. Although we may disagree, but yes, we all have to appreciate that we have reached at this level that we can articulate it well enough to make everyone loud that we have this standpoint. And that courage is required, and that standpoints are required, because our history has been of silent heroes and heroines. So like people like us, or people like us from our community who have such courage, and I also feel that privilege, should make everyone know that we still carry our own views and this thing. And thank you for your opinions. So
hey, Dada Sahib, I would like just to add this basically Sunainath's lecture is very, very what a informative and very studious. I think that is what I realize. She has put a lot of efforts, I think, in getting this particular lecture. And so, Sunaina, thank you very much on behalf of Boston Study Group. And I think this is the first time in our Zoom meeting we have hit around 60-65 attendees on the Zoom, as well as around 10 to 15 in YouTube, and same numbers in Facebook. So I think this is a good sign that many people want to listen to you. And so please keep good work. And thank you very much. And hope to see you in some other forum in near future.
Thank you very much. I feel really honored. And this is really, really moving and, you know, in encouraging discussion we had today. So, and many of the thoughts to take from here and think more and develop more, you know, develop ideas based on this discussion. So I'm really thankful and grateful to you and the Boston Study Group and Dada Sahib and everybody who was participating and engaging with the talk. So, and I wish to see more, you know, events by more seminars or lectures from the Boston Study Group. And I would also like to meet sometime the members of Boston Study Group, which I have met in 2019, but 2019, yes, in October.
Yeah, we met there in New York.
Yeah. So I'd like to meet in person and have some discussion together. It would be really great. So, and I am reachable to everyone through my email. So if anybody has something more to say, I would just write my email here. So anybody could reach me and ask me if anything they want to discuss or questions. And I really enjoyed this conversation. And I really, you know, feel honored to be here and grateful for this organizing this event. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Sumanya. And before I end this session, I would like to inform everyone that 24th April, we are hosting Professor Kancha Ilya Shepherd with his new book. So we'll share the details soon with everyone. So thank you so much for attending and being very active participants and looking
forward. Dada Sahib.
Yes.
I think this is a good opportunity to announce that we are celebrating Babasaheb Ambedkar Jayanti on 18th. Mm-hmm. And we are also publishing this magazine of the BSG, that is the inauguration issue, on the same day. So anybody who is there on, who has provided the email, they are in our email group. So we will try to send the invitations for Ambedkar Jayanti celebration. So please join. And we have a very good magazine coming up. And for the future, anybody is interested, they can provide some article for that also. Great.
Yeah. 18th. What time it is? Like ED?
It is 11:30 Indian Standard Time on Sunday, 18th.
11:30 a.m.
Yeah, that is 11:30 is basically 9 o'clock.
9 p.m. in India.
9 p.m. Indian standard.
Okay. Great. So thank you so much. Bye. Thank you, Sunanya, once more. Good night, Jaybeam.
Thank you, Sunanya. Keep up the good work. This is Subhash Gedam from Iowa.
Great. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Very good talk. Very good study that you have been doing.
Thank you so much, ma'am.